Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we just come before your throne and we pray against the lies that the enemies feed our mind. So we'll lay all of our burdens upon your feet, Lord. We want to make room for you.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. Every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever.
Do whatever you want to, Lord, and church. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? Yeah. 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? I'm not enough. I'm not enough unless you come.
God's word says, where two or more are gathered, I am here with you. He's here with us. So let's just surrender to him our hearts. Lord Jesus, there are moments where we want to just, our circumstances, we want to try to control them, but only to realize that we have little to no control to do so. And we, apart from you, we are powerless. So right now we redirect our hearts and our lives to you, Lord. Because only through you that we can find strength, peace, and joy that only you can give. So come, Lord Jesus, we open up our hearts to you. Come fill this place with your presence. Fill our hearts and fill our lives with you. Help us through our challenges, because without you, we are powerless. We lift you up in your precious name, we pray. And everyone say amen.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Sharon, and I'd like to welcome you to New Hope Windward. Thank you for joining us today. In a few moments, we're going to hear a great message. But before we do, we're going to worship God through our giving. As you know, next weekend is our Easter services, and traditionally, it's the largest attended of our services in the entire year. That will be a major win for God's kingdom, as hundreds of new guests you helped invite will commit their lives to Christ for the very first time. All of heaven will be cheering for sure. In preparation for Easter, as a church, we pour a tremendous amount of resources, manpower, and finances into creating the most inspiring and heartfelt experience possible for the hundreds of guests who will join us that weekend. Last Christmas, 319 people made commitments to Christ, and our hope and prayer is that even more will do the same at our Easter services next weekend. New Hope Windward, it's through your faithfulness and generosity we are able to reach for Christ many who likely only attend church at most once or twice a year, like Easter. Your giving is truly making a significant kingdom difference, not just at our live in-person services at Regal, but also for the thousands who tune in online. So thank you, New Hope Windward. We simply wouldn't be able to do church without you. At the bottom of the screen, you'll see three easy, safe, and secure ways to donate, or you can scan the QR code. Also, by clicking the button on the upper right-hand corner of your screen, it'll take you to our website where you can give a one-time gift or have it recurring. Would you bow your heads with me as I lead us in prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you for the many in our church who are vested partners with you to reach the many hundreds of unchurched in our local community and online at our largest outreach opportunity of the year this Easter. Through their ongoing sacrifice and generosity, we give today in faith and with a heart to build your kingdom and invest in things that matter for eternity. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, all you dance enthusiasts! Back by popular demand, our School of Dance will be offering dance classes in sign dance and hula for teens and adults, as well as for keiki from 5 to 12 years of age. Classes start April 4th and will run for 8 weeks, ranging from beginners to advanced, so all are welcome to participate. And the best part, classes are absolutely free. Space is limited, so if you are attending service at Regal Cinemas today, stop by the School of Dance table in the lobby after service, or if you're joining us online, email info@nhww.org. Well, Easter is finally upon us. Next weekend, we'll be celebrating 5 powerful Easter services at both in-person services and online. In fact, take a look.
All right, that's going to be awesome, y'all. So, good morning or good afternoon, whenever you're watching this. I am TJ, I'm part of the teaching team here. And if you're new to our church or you're just joining us online for the first time, we're so glad to have you here. We wanted to make a safe space. Anybody could come and figure out this Jesus thing for themselves. Today, I want to start and just ask you a question. And the question is this: have you ever had it where you were searching for something that was right in front of your face? You ever had this happen to you? I'm not talking like the thing where, like, have you ever like looked for your phone and your phone was in your hand the whole time? You guys ever did this? Or like your glasses and they're on your head? Like the obvious ones, right? We've done that, but more so stuff where like you're looking for like an opportunity or you're looking for a certain person or something, you know, searching it out, what job, career, and that, and you just don't even realize it's been there all along. You ever had this happen to you? Give you an example of what this would look like for me. When I was, I've told some of you guys some of this story. If you're new, I just want to catch you up in this. But for me, when I was younger, I wanted to be one of those guys that, you know, got on with life early. Like, I was like, oh, I want to be married by 30. Like, if I'm not married by 30, I had all these deals of people that I would just get married to, kind of thing. You ever did that kind of thing? So I had this whole thing in that, and I didn't get married till way past 30 in that. But this was, you know, this is a picture, for those of you who know, this is my wife, Jules. We got married, you know, about 5 years ago and that. And I remember, like, you know, sometimes we'll go out to eat with people and they'll sit down and they'll ask us, like, how did you guys get together, you know? And you know, this story where, like, you walk in and, like, you see them and everything slows down and you're like, that's the one. That wasn't us at all. Like, not even a little bit. Like, I remember we actually were absolute enemies in this. Absolute enemies in there. And the reason wasn't because, like, oh, you know, like, she's not attractive to me, I'm not attractive to her. It was just, we were different people back then. So I remember I met Jules in my 20s, and I was like, I cannot stand her. Matter of fact, I was a, is this too honest for you? Sorry, we're that kind of church. So I remember, like, I was a young adults pastor at the time, and she had come, and my friend, like, hey, this girl's pretty cool, I think you should get to know her, just as a friend in that. I remember I was in the parking lot talking to her, and I don't know what came over me. I can't believe I even said this, but I remember saying to her, like, you know what, I don't really like you. It's the young adults pastor, right? And she goes, well, good, because I don't like you either. And I said, great, we're on the same page. And I walked away. That's a true story. Now, obviously, that is not a great young adults pastor. We were different creatures back in that time. And so what happened, I even brought a picture of this. I remember even after all this was back in the days, my friend Kaleo and that. We were traveling in that, and we invited some friends, and like, oh, we're going to bring this girl, Jules, too, on this trip. And I was like, no, you know, like in that. So I just had this huge history in there, and it's mutual feeling on this, okay? So what happens? How does this change on that? Well, it ends up that this girl ends up being in the same proximity for me all the time. And like, I remember we were even in India, we're on a mission trip. She ends up being on this mission trip. I was doing jiu-jitsu here in Hawaii. I had this, like, I was on this mat. I guess the guys didn't, like, wash it. So I got this, like, ringworm thing, if you guys know what ringworm is. And I got it in Oahu, and we were on the planes going over to India, and this thing took over. Like, it was growing over my head. And so I'm in the mountains in India, and this thing's eating my whole head, and the only person that would take care of me was Jules, right? And I'm like, all right, I guess this girl's okay, right? But that was just like, I warmed up a little bit, right? And she was like, she'll tell you, I was kind of like forced to take care of him because this thing's eating his head. You know, like, I guess I'll help him. Like, so we have this whole thing, and still yet, not interested, whatever, you know? So this was back in the days. So sorry if this has a point, I'm just telling you, but you'll see how this works. This was back in the days where, like, there was a little bit of, like, shame to, like, online dating. You guys remember this? And so I remember I was like, 30 came and went. I was still single. Like, what? So I said, you know what? I'm going to do online dating. So I did eHarmony. You guys remember this? They're like, we will match you up based on 29 different characteristics. All you need to do is pay $65.99. Who would do that? I paid $65.99. So I did that, right? Paid $65.99. They're like, guess what? We found a match for you. I was like, yes. I opened it up. Guess who it said? Jules. So her side, she's same thing. I guess I'll try this. She opens it up, TJ, she's like, ew, shuts it down. This is our story, okay? This whole thing, this is all true. So it gets to the point now where I'm that, and I'm kind of like mid-30s in there, and I remember I was kind of like that, and all of a sudden, I have friends and family that kind of stay out of stuff. And out of nowhere, within 1 month, this happens. February, my best friend's talking to me. He's like, hey, you remember that girl? What was her name? Jules? How come you never, like, made that work? I was like, well, I mean, I don't know. And then my mom, who stays out of it completely, she's like, you guys remember that girl, Jules? This is like a week later. I'm like, yeah. I fly to India by myself. I'm living in the mountains. Now, I work a lot with the underground church, some of these different places. This guy I'm working with, he's like a Navy SEAL. Like, he's tougher than tough. Like, the guy got surrounded by a mob that tried to set him on fire kind of thing. The guy's just rock solid. I mean, tough. Not a soft guy. And he's like, hey, you want to come take a walk with me in the village? I'm like, yeah, we're in the mountains. We're going out. We're doing it. I'm like, just me and him, right? Walking. He's like, hey, I want to ask you a question. Okay. You remember that girl that, like, I was like, you've got to be kidding me. It was no joke. And then that moment I realized, like, it was like God being like, hello, like, this is what I've had for you all along in this way. It was 10 years like that. Now, how could it be that for 10 years, something's right there and you don't recognize it's there. How can that be? Now, some of you guys are like, I don't know, man, what's wrong with you? You are slow. Now, you'll say that to me there, but I'll tell you this. Each and every one of us do this in some way, shape, or form, do we not? Sometimes what happens is our expectation of what life should look like, what the answer to prayer should be, how things should actually come about, what it ends up doing is it ends up blinding us from what it is that God actually wants to do right in front of our face. And if it's not for sometimes the right people, the right friends, something that's said in church, sometimes for many of us, we will miss what God wants to do because we're so busy just trying to focus on what we think life should look like. And what I want to tell you today, what we're going to look at today is God has more for you than you realize. But for many of us, what we need to be able to do is actually be able to push past our expectations of it and be able to see the surprising path that he's going to take us down to bring us to a place of fulfillment in life. Now, the good news for me is that I'm not the only slow one. When I read scripture, Jesus' disciples, they were slow too. Check this out. So these things his disciples did not understand at the first. In other words, people that were following Jesus, they had some crazy things happen to them. Things that for many people be like, it's obvious. But for them, it wasn't so obvious. It says when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered these things were written of him, that they had done these things for him. See, in the scriptures, people don't realize this about the Bible. The scriptures, it really points towards Jesus, if you will. Now, what happens is if you're new to church, it's divided into the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, what it constantly did is it constantly gave these, we'll call it signs. The church word for this is prophecy. Prophecy sounds weird to some of us, especially if you don't have church background in that. But basically, all that means is a way that God's going to say, hey, when you see this, then you're going to know that this is happening. I'm going to give you a sign, something that you know, hey, when you see this. So for me, in my case, come back to my Jules story on that. All of a sudden, it's like God started putting different people all around me that weren't connected saying the same thing. Make sense? In that moment, it was like, oh, I get it. This is what you're trying to say. God spent a ton of time in the Old Testament saying, hey, you know what? I'm going to paint something for you. I'm going to do this. So if you want to know the context, today's Palm Sunday, if you didn't know that. Palm Sunday is the Sunday before when we celebrate Easter, and it signifies a specific event, but I want to talk about that a little bit, but I want to bring it back to how sometimes you and I, we miss on expectation. The Jews during this time, they were suffering. They were in hardship. There was a people called the Romans that had overtook them. They oppressed them. They took money from them. They taxed them. They weren't allowed to function as a people as they were meant to function. It was bad. And they found themselves in a place where they were praying like crazy. God, would you just show up? By the way, can I tell you this? One of the things that I've just noticed over the last 20 years working with people who believe in God, people don't believe in God. You know, both people, typically, they end up praying. Did you know that? Especially when life gets hard. Is that not true? Sometimes people pray, man, I'm relationally at my wit's end. I don't know what to do with this man. I don't know what to do with this woman. I don't know what to do with this kid. God, if you would only show me, I would do it. Man, financial hardship is looming. Disaster seems around the corner. I'm freaking out. God, would you just provide something in there? And so tons of people are praying, and what they're praying for is that God would give an answer. But again, what happens sometimes, the problem isn't are we praying, the problem is are our expectations blinding us to God answering that prayer. And in this sense with the Jews, what was happening, they were praying, God, would you just send us someone to set us free? And a matter of fact, God had been answering for hundreds of years saying, I am going to send the Messiah, somebody who's going to show up and they're going to change everything. And so you know what it's going to be like. I'll give you different signs or different prophecies. And so they'd give some of those in there. So one of the things you got to know in this is what's crazy. There were so many prophecies written about Jesus that it would be the chances of somebody fulfilling even just a few of them is mind-boggling. So I won't tell you how many prophecies are written yet. You can guess if you know it. But I'll just tell you this. Let's say the chances of Jesus fulfilling just 8 of these prophecies. Just eight. What do you guys think the number is for the chance of him fulfilling eight? Anyone guess? Like, I don't know, 1 in 100, 1 in that. Like, it's actually this number right here. So just eight now. It would be this. It's 1 in 10 to the 17, okay? What is that? Now, this is a mathematician that actually went through this. So this is like hundreds, thousands, millions, billions, trillions. Anybody know what this is? I'm like gazillion, quadrillion, I don't know, you know, like, now that doesn't mean a lot to any of us, so let me just illustrate this, what this would look like, just so you can kind of understand. This is it. Let's say you took Hawaii, and you took the land mass of Hawaii, and let's say that you covered Hawaii in, like, just silver dollars, okay? All of it. Big Island, Oahu, Kauai, everything. And you did it up to 4 feet. And then let's say that you just put one tiny mark on one of these silver dollars and you threw it somewhere randomly on one of the islands and you mixed all of it up. Let's see, you had this magic stick type thing, right? Now, let's say you blindfold somebody, you put them out there and you tell them, walk as long as you like, and when you're ready, I want you to bend down and pick that up. And you know what? If you get the X, you're the winner, okay? Now, if you find somebody like that, let's go to the 9th island to Vegas, because that's pretty lucky, you know what I mean? Like, the chances of that is pretty wild in there, but here, this isn't even the same. That's not even the number you saw. In order for it to be accurate, what you actually have to do is take not 2 Hawaiis, not 4 Hawaiis, not even 8 Hawaiis, you actually need 20 Hawaiis together, 4 feet, stacked with silver dollars, one tiny thing, one mark. That's the same probability of one person filling just eight. Is that crazy? Mind-blowing, that's eight. Now, here's the thing that blew your mind even more. How many prophecies do you think Jesus actually fulfilled? 324. 324. You saw 1 in 8. So in other words, this is the guy. There's no doubt about it. Look at some of these prophecies. It'd be stuff like this. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming. The guy you've been waiting for, he's righteous and endowed with salvation. He's going to save you. Humble and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So it's saying, hey, when your king comes, he's going to be riding on a donkey. Now, here's what's crazy. This was written with Zechariah. This is written 500 years before Palm Sunday. Just to give you some perspective, that's twice as long as the United States has been a country. 500 years later, that's where we're going to pick up the story today. But this is one of 324. Just one of them. Hey, this is what it's going to be like. And so when you come later and we pick the story up, this is the Palm Sunday story. We're going to read it from John. It says, on the next day, when a large crowd that had come to the feast, they heard Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. They then took the branches of palm trees, went out to meet him, and began shouting, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, indeed the King of Israel. So these guys are praying. God, I'm waiting for you to show up to give us some sort of solution. People start wondering, is this it? Is this the guy? So what they do is they come because Jesus, they're coming into a feast. So this is the time of year, it's Passover. Everybody from all of Israel, they all try to go to Jerusalem. So the city swells. There's like hundreds of thousands of people. It's crazy. And they're there and they line the street. Now for us, how many of you guys are thinking, you know what? If I ever saw God answering one of my questions, you know what I would do? I would grab a palm branch. That's what I would do. Anybody thinking that right now? Because I'm not, right? So like, it doesn't mean a lot to us because culturally that doesn't match for us. But culturally back then it meant something. So it might look something like this, grab palm branches. Now, I don't know about you, when I think of a palm branch, you know what I honestly think of? Like ancient world, they would like take a palm branch and like fan you. Anybody else think of that? Like, oh, that feels nice. Like, are they fanning Jesus? Is that what they're doing in there? Well, let me use a kind of like a Hawaii illustration. Imagine if you walked in and you saw somebody wearing this. A maile leaf, you know, like tea leaf around that. How many guys would think, oh, they're just trying to wear cute flowers. That's so nice. Or cute leaves. They like maybe they like leaves in there. In our culture, if somebody's wearing this, it's like, okay, wait, like, is it your birthday? Are you getting married? There's some sort of significance, right? Because when we use leis, there usually means something to it. Now, the rest of the world, it's not just because, oh, it smells nice and it looks nice. Different leis will indicate different things. Matter of fact, like graduation time, we go nuts with lei. It's a sign of honor. Is that not true? I was looking at my college graduation. I had to bring a picture because this blew my mind. This was me at college graduation. That's Dave. Isn't that crazy? We've been friends now. We're known each other 20 years in that. This is 20 years ago in there. But when you look at this, this is a way of like, oh, I was being honored that night because of all the work that was kind of put in. Now, if you come back and you look to these palm branches, when they're waving these palm branches, it has deep kauna or deep meaning for them. Matter of fact, years before, they had thrown off other oppressors, and the palm branch was actually one of their signs for being able to rise up and overcome. It was a sign of being able to like actually recapture what's rightfully ours, almost like a sign of rebellion in there. So when they're waving palm branches, they're not saying like, oh, I hope you feel nice and cool in the heat of the day. They're saying the time is coming finally for us to rise and become who we're meant to be. You see that? That's Palm Sunday. It's not a calm, just like, oh, that's cute. Jesus is on a cute donkey and he's got the cute fans going on that. It's like, man, this is the expectation that maybe our time has come. So they're waving this thing. Now you can see it too, because the phrase that they say, Hosanna. Now we sing that. Church people, you sing that sometimes, right? There's that song like, Hosanna, Hosanna. I'm not going to sing because you'll leave the church. But I just imagine if I could sing, I would sing it. Now we sing these things, and church people, if I can just poke fun at us sometimes, we're notorious for using words that sometimes we have no idea what they actually mean. I remember there's this one word, people, I walked around, they'd be like, Maranatha. Like, what does Maranatha mean? The guy's like, I don't know. Like, the other guy said it. You know, it's like, okay, like, Hosanna. What does Hosanna actually mean? Is that like another way for, say, Jesus' name? Like, it's actually a term. It's actually an actual phrase, and this is what it means. Hosanna means save us now. It's a very clear phrase. It's not just save us. It's save us now. That urgency. Have you ever been in a situation where you need something to happen now? I'm out of money. I need help now. It's not just a desire thing. It's an urgency thing. When they're lining the street, they are saying, crying out, Hosanna, like, save us now. That's what he's saying in that space. Now, we live in a world today where the truth is a lot of us, we're actually have that same undergirding feeling where we're saying, save us now. We may not use that word save us, but there's something where we're just saying, man, if this could only be fixed or changed, it would change everything. I've had so much pain in my family that I would take anything to happen just to change that and turn that thing around. We live in a day and age where we all have something undergirding this like this. Like, I'll just throw out a couple examples. That broken relationship thing I just mentioned, that's a thing, right? I know people that are wildly successful in the world. I mean, just crazy. Their business takes off. They've made a ton of money. But you know what they're saying in the private conversations? Because we get to hear this from time to time. They're actually saying, save me now. Because as successful as I've been everywhere else, I cannot find success with my kids. My marriage, my relationships are so broken and it hurts so bad. I have no idea what to do. I just need something to save me. You know this if you have this with your children, if you're a parent and your kid's kind of on a wayward path. I mean, I talk to you guys after service and pray with you and I see it's like just, it breaks your heart. Save me. It's not just save you in that instance. You're like, save us. I need you, God, to do something with my kid, you know? It's an undergirded thing. Other people that have this, they need to be saved just from the pain of life. See, for some of us in here, maybe this is you. Maybe you're here and, you know, you follow Jesus and you've done everything right. And sometimes the expectation is because I follow Jesus, everything's going to move smooth. But maybe for you, some things haven't moved smooth. Maybe some things have happened that have really hurt. Maybe that relationship that you're banking on, your marriage, maybe they actually ended up leaving. And get divorced. It wasn't what you wanted, but it's something that happened or they cheated on you in there. And in these moments, what can happen sometimes is those kind of things, they just taint us. You know what I mean? They just go in there, it leaves this bad taste in your mouth. And it's like, well, that's life. It's like, yeah, but I'm like, just start feeling like, kind of like, you're not out, but you just kind of feel like a little bit, you know, jaded. Does that make sense? And no matter what you do, you can't just flip the jaded switch and turn it off. And then you see other things happen all around, and it just starts to get to you over time. And I know this for me because this is one, I haven't experienced the marriage break, but I've experienced things happen to me that it just like friends turn their back on me, other things and that. This is all when I'm following God in that. And I realize sometimes, I remember looking back, it's like, it's not that I'm hopeless, but I'm just jaded. Anybody ever been there before? And when I'm jaded, what I really need is I am in need of saving in that moment. I need saving because my heart is just sick. And I'm like, God, would you just restore my sense of hope? Restore that sense of like, hey, that things are going to go in the right direction. Because sometimes that just happens to me in there. I know some people that I just talked to somebody this week, straight out of the pandemic did that to them. Just threw them into a funk. They just got lost somewhere along the way. Some people, they'll have this where they have hopeless situations. God, would you just save me from a hopeless situation? I'm facing a health diagnosis. A friend that I just met, he has cancer, facing this huge cancer diagnosis. It feels hopeless. And man, this guy, this is actually how he found Jesus, believe it or not. Cancer hit him on there, and he was so successful everywhere else. Now he's facing something that he can't save himself. And he starts praying, God, would you save me? Would you show up? I don't know what else to do. Just throw a couple more out there. Some people, they just get lost along the way. When I was praying this week, I felt like some of that, and you might know somebody like this, that, you know, maybe they were good, they were walking with God, and just somewhere they just started to drift. And I'm not saying that, you know, like they're off in the deep end making terrible choices, but, you know, they start getting disconnected from God's people, from church. They start getting disconnected over here. And it's not like they're going out of control being just crazy, but it's just like certain things start to just get off. And it's like the slow drift. I talked to a ton of people that actually from the pandemic, that happened to them. They used to be thriving. Then because of the whole disruption in church, everything else, it's like they're not off, but they're not thriving with God like they used to. They just got lost somewhere along the way. And you know what they're actually in need of? Saving. That sounds like a very judgment term, but I've talked to the people that are in this. And what they'll say is like, I had no idea, because when they come back and they realize, like when they start thriving with Jesus, they always say the same thing. They're like, I just had no idea like how much I miss this, how much I need this, how much life I feel in this. I had no idea. I just got lost along the way. Does that make sense? There's different things everywhere. Of course, when it comes to saving, this is the one in our culture too, is sometimes people think that they can save themselves. And the truth is you just can't. You just can't. A lot of times, like I have friends that, you know, they came out of AA, and one of the best things that they said when AA, the first step is they recognize that they need a higher power. They just can't do it on their own. As long as they keep thinking they could do it on their own, I'm my own savior, my own master, they just kept getting stuck over and over. I watch people deal with this all the time. I'm going to overcome this part of my character or this part of this or do this and that. And usually it only comes with their end of themselves, and they're ready to allow God to step in, that they experience the actual breakthrough. Now, this is on this side of eternity. But if you actually flip it now and you talk about eternity now, the truth is that none of us can save ourselves when it comes to being right with God. The mistake most people make with religion, church, you name it, whatever, is they think they can earn their way back with God. You ask people walking down the street, hey, why do people go to heaven? You know what the number one answer people say is? Because they're a good person. Do you know that good people don't go to heaven? I mean it. Good people don't go to heaven. Because the problem is, how good is good enough, right? Like if I was to put me next to like Pastor Dave, I'm like, hey, which one of us is better? You know, like, and what would be the answer to that? I'm on stage. There's one right answer right now. Just come on now, people. But the point is, you get to this thing. Some of you guys are like, is it TJ? Yeah, so get to this thing in there, and you get this like good enough, because I know somebody I'm better than, and I know somebody that I'm worse than. But the truth is, when it comes to heaven, the only people that go to heaven are perfect people. And how many of us are perfect? None of us. And you're like, well, how is that fair then? It's fair because God knows this is how this works. And so what he did is sent Jesus to not only teach, to not only heal, but to die on a cross. And through his blood, do you know in God's eyes, when you put your faith in Jesus, you're actually perfect? Perfect. Meaning he literally removes anything that you've done. Part of some of our problem there, I wasn't going to say this today, but I just feel like I'm supposed to right now. Some of you in here, you struggle so much because you feel like I've messed up so much. Man, how I'm so bad because of this. And you have all these thoughts about yourself that God no longer has about you at all. He doesn't look at you and think any of that. You're just stuck in your past thinking like that. But when the blood of Jesus got applied and put over you, it's gone to him. You're completely made new. That's what we're talking about here. This is Jesus. He's going to die in less than a week when he comes to Palm Sunday. He's showing up. They're expecting a conquering king. The same group of people. This is what's so crazy too. They're there. They're like, Hosanna, save us. Because what they're expecting, come in on a war horse and whip the Romans. Crush them. They expect a conquering king, but Jesus shows up as a suffering servant. He doesn't come in saying, hey, serve me. Matter of fact, when he eats the Last Supper, he gets on his knees and he washes his disciples' feet, saying the world uses leadership to lord over everyone else, but in the kingdom, we lead by serving. The world says, crush everybody. Jesus says, if you allow yourself to be crushed, God will raise you up. And when he dies on the cross and he rises 3 days later, it changes everything. You see how this works in there? There's this pattern in this theme. So what happens is Jesus, he finds a young donkey. That sound familiar? A colt. And he sits on it. As is written, do not fear, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming seated on a donkey's colt. We read this at the beginning, you remember? This was the thing that was written 500 years ago about him. These things his disciples did not understand because they're slow, like me. And at this moment, what it's basically saying is in their very midst, the thing that God had always promised is going to be fulfilled right then and there. But they can't see it. The same crowd who seems Hosanna in a matter of days would then flip and say, crucify him. Why? Because you didn't show up like I thought you were going to. They missed it completely on there. It's a wild thing in there. And here's what's so crazy on God. Now, have you ever had friends that like turn on you like that? Like on one day, they're like, I'm in for life. And then 3 days later, like, nah, forget you. I'm moving on to this thing here. Like, I can't stand being around people like that. Anybody else? Truth is sometimes I am a person like that, and so are you, because that's just sometimes what happens in nature and that. But here's what blows me away about God. Even in the middle of people like that, he says, I'm still going to love them. I'm still going to die for them. Jesus, even on the cross, he says this, forgive them, for they don't even understand what they're doing. Oh, it's crazy. Like, that's God's love on, like, display. And so what happens is, you know, they don't understand. Like, you see that scripture we're talking about. And then what moves on is that it steps into the space, and then Jesus goes and he says, okay, I'm going to lay down my life for them. And he does the thing that's unthinkable and changes all of eternity in that moment. Now, here's what's crazy. Those same people, what happens is after Jesus dies and raised up, there's a story of the road to Emmaus, these guys walking along the road, and they're describing when they're around Jesus. And they start using these phrases. They say things like this, like, man, when we were with him and when he talked, it's like something came alive inside of me. Like, I don't know how to describe it, but something came to life. Now, if you're here and you're a Christian, can you just raise your hand if you've ever experienced something like that? Go ahead and do that now. Okay, there's people's hands going on all around. What they're describing is an encounter with God. It's a tricky thing to get, because what happens sometimes is when Jesus actually shows up, many times the way that a lot of us meet Jesus, it's not in the way that we expect. I know guys in here, they were completely, completely self-sufficient. They thought they were doing great. They were making a ton of money, and their family wasn't in disarray. And all of a sudden, they were in church one day, and something happened to them. And it wasn't like they were so convicted that they were like, my whole life's so messed up. They literally had this thing happen inside of them where it's like their soul came alive. And it just shocked them. They only came to church because their wife was doing something and they came to support. Like, she was sharing that day. So they're like, okay, I'll just come support you. I don't believe any of this. I kind of think it's bogus. That was them completely, right? Now that guy, he'd be the number one guy. When I talk to him, the biggest thing, he's like, you got to help me, dude. Like, help you what? He's like, I have all these friends. They just don't even know what they're missing out on, man. Like, I can't live without Jesus now. Remember, this guy was hyper successful, but something hit him. He wasn't expecting it. It came. I know people that came in, part of what brought them into church, they were like, God, I pray you restore my marriage. Now, I know some people, they experienced restoration. But I know other people, they prayed it, but it takes two people to make a successful marriage. Is that not true? And this person left anyways. But you know what happened in the middle of this? They were here praying for restoration. You know who they met instead? Jesus. And they will sit there and tell you, they're not happy their marriage ended. But they'll tell you, I experienced the greatest thing I've ever experienced in my life in the midst of one of the darkest places in my life. And it sustains me. I wish I could bring them up here to tell you. Like, because when you hear them talk, it doesn't make any sense. But what happened was, is Jesus in that moment, he saved them, and they will tell you that. So, well, what about the marriage? You didn't save the marriage. It's like, yep, because that one, it took two people, and that person was completely unwilling. But this one, when they came, they thought they were coming just for restored marriage, but they got a restored life. They got a restored heart. They are thriving. And that. Because sometimes what's happening is we have different desires in our heart and we think that this is going to satisfy us, but it really doesn't. The only thing that's going to truly satisfy is Jesus. I know some people, they're praying for success. God, give me success. You know what they're really after? For some cases, they're after just a sense of significance. If I'm successful, then I'll be seen well, then I'll feel better. And I've talked to guys, like, I get to sit with sometimes the people who are famous or celebrities, and they've had the whole world given to them, been extremely successful. And they said, on the other side, I was so shocked because it was so empty. It just didn't deliver. And other people, that they're praying, God, I need that person in my life. And what they're actually praying for in that person, they don't realize it. They're actually praying, God, I feel lonely and I don't want to feel alone. And then they go and they get married and they think that marriage is going to solve this thing. And they're completely distraught when they realize it didn't solve it. And then they encounter Jesus. And what makes no sense to them is all of a sudden they don't feel alone anymore. Like, I know that's my story on that. I like wanted to be married. I saw that. But really, it's like I just didn't want to be lonely on that. And what happened was, I can remember this to this day. I had this time with Jesus where it was just like, he literally just felt like he said, I'll never leave you and forsake you, which is in scripture. But for some reason in this moment, I remember the room I was in. I was praying with this person. I was weeping. I had no idea what was happening on this. And from that day forward, I never felt alone like I did before that ever again. You can't make this stuff up. Does that make sense? My whole point I'm trying to get, you remember that Hosanna, this person, this person, this person, these type of situations? Guys, if you're here and you know Jesus, you've seen him show up and meet you in different ways and save you in that. But we are surrounded by a world that is searching in so many different ways. And they're just saying, God, I'm looking for fulfillment. I'm looking for life. I'm looking for safety. They might think they're looking for something, but they don't realize that what they're looking for really is actually Jesus. The true fulfillment in there. And the thing that I forget, because I've been a Christian too long, I forget what it's like to not have life with Jesus. I forget it. And every time somebody new comes in, I get to hear your story, it just reminds me, because there's a world out there and there's a ton of good people that are just hurting on that. And why it's good to remember is you and I, we know what's actually going to satisfy. But sometimes we don't extend an invitation, if you will. We don't find a way. It's like we know, but we don't know how to get people to that place. And I'll tell you, like I said, this is me. I do this all the time in this. It's like I know Jesus, I just forget. And the reality is, when you look at scripture, you may or may not like this, but it's true. One of God's primary tools he's going to use to save people, to reach people, to help them experience the fulfillment they're looking for is actually you and me. It's his plan. It's always been his plan. The gospel, scriptures, the Ark of the Covenant, it was always carried on the backs of men. It's just part of God's plan. Now, I don't know why he chose it that way, but he did choose it that way. I'll show you it straight from scripture. It says this, how then are they calling them who they have not believed? How are they to believe in him who they've not heard? And how are they to hear without a preacher? How are they to preach unless they are sent? Just as is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. The reason we're talking about this today, one, I feel like some of you guys in here, you're searching and God's actually answering in ways that you just don't recognize. It's right in front of you. For some of you, that's Jesus, but others of you, you already know Jesus. It's his answers right there. But sometimes you're just, your expectations are getting in the way. But the second reason, and probably the bigger reason we're talking about this today, is there is an entire world that's looking for Jesus. They just don't know it. And you're part of a church that this is what we do, guys. We make a safe place for people to come in. Like next week's Easter. Do you know that Easter is the number one time people are willing to come to church? It's the number one time. It's more than Christmas. Christmas, they got all their Christmas plans, everything else. Not much people have Easter plans because Easter is definitely a holiday built on Jesus. You know what I'm saying? And what happens is there's a ton of people, you may not know this, but if you were to invite them, they would actually say yes. They would actually come. I've told a ton of stories what this is like for me. My favorite one I tell is just this guy that I worked out with in the gym, like for years. And then I didn't want to pressure him. And then his seventh grade student invited him, came to Easter, got saved, right? God showed up. And then he showed up at the gym like 6 months later, and he's like, can I ask you a question? I was like, yeah, well, anything, man. He's like, how come for all those years you never invited me to church, man? I don't know. I didn't want to pressure you. I didn't want to make you feel weird. And he's like, but this is one of the best things that's ever happened to me. I'm like, you wouldn't even invite me? I don't know. You know, I mean, it's just like, that's like a feeling on that. This was after I was a pastor, to be honest with you. And we just have this bad notion in our head. When you invite somebody, you're not forcing Jesus on them. You're just giving them a chance to put them in a space. Next week, it's going to be awesome. We have all this stuff set up in that. We have this testimony video of somebody sharing a real life story. Absolutely mind-blowing on that. What needs to happen in the partnership, what we're trying to do is we're partnering with you is to preach the gospel to your friends. To give a chance and an explanation in there. Some of you guys are like, I have no idea what I would say. We can deal with that on a different day. For this next week, we're all partnering together to do this. Pastor Dave is going to preach the gospel so clear, and who cares how clear it is or not, the power of God's going to be here, and God's going to show up in power on that. We got to partner with this. That's why we do a lot of this. You guys walked in, there's three things on your seat. You guys saw these? It's because we're praying for each and every one of us to invite people to Easter. Why? Because we want our church to be the biggest in all of Hawaii. No, we could care less. We don't care. We don't care. Man, we just care people meet Jesus, you know? We just want to give them a chance to meet Jesus. And so I want to challenge you here. If you're part of the church, I'm talking to you right now. We need to be people to extend invitations. I want you to invite at least two people. If you haven't, I just want you to shoot text right after this. If you're nervous about it, I'm nervous about it too. After years on this, it still don't feel so comfortable and confident. But there's people that the Holy Spirit's been hitting my heart over and over. I need to invite them this week. I'm telling you that because I feel the same thing as you feel in there. I'm going to do it. Does that make sense? I want us to kind of pray into that and be able to do that. So even when it comes to Easter, here's the details, just if you don't know. We put extra services on Easter because this is the time they're willing. At 5 and 6:45, we've got services at Windward Community College. It's at the Hale Akoa room. Did I say that right? No. Akoa. Yep. Now, if you know where that room is, raise your hand if you know where that room is. One of us. Nobody else. Okay? This is what you're going to do. You're going to go to Windward Community College, and there's going to be, it's crazy, a New Hope Windward sign. And you just follow the New Hope Windward signs, and it will take you there. Does that make sense? Here's what I'm going to ask. If you're coming next week and you're bringing somebody, by the way, do that. When you invite them, say, hey, if you want, you can come with me and even sit together. If they're willing to come on there, you come whenever you want. But if you're coming next week by yourself, I have a request for you. I need you to come to 5 o'clock on Saturday, or I need you to come Sunday morning at 7. Some of you guys are like, I don't even wake up by 7. Well, next week at Easter, you're going to wake up at 7, kid. Because the reason why, we need space for people to come hear the gospel. And they will come at 8:30 and 10. 7 is a hard sell for a lot of people that don't. Does that make sense? So if you're coming solo, what services are you coming to? 5 and 7. It's just 1 week, okay? 1 week in there. But here's the key. We don't want you to come solo, do we? We want you to bring somebody with you. And in that case, it's wide open in there. Make sense? Now, the other thing, in the past, we've had to reserve seats and tickets, but we just feel like that's an extra barrier for people. So you do not have to reserve tickets at all. Does that make sense? So sometimes people are like, well, I don't know if I can go to this service. Don't worry about any of that. We're going to make space because the people who aren't bringing somebody, they're coming at 5 and 7. And all of us, we're praying as we bring people in that there's going to be a powerful move of God. Amen? Okay, last thing on this from just Easter before we wrap. We're going to take communion today. The last thing about Easter is we just need a couple people that might be willing to help. Maybe you're here today, you invited, some people said, hey, I can't make it. Don't feel guilty on that. The goal for us isn't if people say yes or no. Success for us just looks like, did you invite? That's all that matters. And maybe they didn't invite and they can't do it, but maybe say, okay, what do I do? How can I partner? I want to help reach people that weekend. We just need a couple people that would help just for this weekend in a different way. Might just help them like set up a breakdown or parking. I can tell you this, one of the things I remember pulling into like a new church, a new thing, it's the parking guys that made the biggest impact on me. Anybody else have this happen? Because I'm like, dude, your role's rubbish, man. That doesn't look fun at all. And they're like in a good mood and they gave me a shock on that. And I'm like, well, these people are in a, like, these are nice people. It just makes sense. Little stuff like that makes huge difference on there. So if you scan this QR code, this is what it'll look like. This is from my phone. It'll just pop up. It'll ask you just a few questions. But if you'd be willing to help, listen, for less than 90 minutes, it's going to be huge. But next week, it's big for us, guys. We're going to honor Jesus by celebrating the resurrection, but we're also going to honor him by celebrating what the resurrection did. And that's opened up an invitation for anybody to come to the Father. And the best way we can do that is to partner with him to give as many people a chance to hear the gospel as clear as they possibly can. Like, that's one of the reasons why he died on the cross. It's one of the things that he wants more than anything else. You know, if you have your elements today, we're gonna take communion. And communion was taken the day before he died on the cross. And we're going to read a passage on this, so I'm going to explain the logistics of this. But basically, if you grab this cup, you don't have a cup, you're in any of the theaters, you can just raise your hand. If you're at home or watching this online, you can pause it or go grab, like, it doesn't need to be, like, special bread. You could grab, like, any bread. You could grab rice if you wanted to, because it's not about the thing, it's about what it represents. On the top of this, there's a little thin one that's see-through. You peel that back, you're going to get this wafer thing on the top. You can do that now, and then after that, we're going to peel the other one. But the reason we do this is Jesus did this. That's why. It says this. This is the night before he's going to die on the cross. This is after Palm Sunday. This is Thursday. He comes in on Sunday. They're screaming, save us. Thursday, he has dinner, and he does this on Friday. They're going to flip from saying, save us, to crucify him. It says he takes a cup and he gives thanks. And he gave it to them saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is being poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. I say to you, I'll not drink of this fruit again from now until that day when I drink with you new in a Father in heaven. He also says about the bread, this is my body that's going to be broken for you. If you can you actually take that thing, the bread, and can you break it in your fingers right now before we eat it? And I just want you to recognize that you being made right with God, it costs something. It costs something. It costs Jesus getting his body broken and spilling his blood for us. Now, before we take this, I want to tell one final story. Remember that guy I told you, like the Navy SEAL dude? That's like unreal underground church. I remember sitting with him, and he goes to places that nobody knows Jesus. I can't tell you where it is. I can't tell you who he is because it's just dangerous. And he's got a family. He's got a loving wife. I mean, he puts a lot of risk on it. He's telling me a story about community. He says, one day I was sitting with a guy in a village, and this guy is just radical. The guy got sick, and he was sitting there in his hut, and he remembered like 15, 20 years ago, there was somebody in a village talking about a guy who could heal. And what they're talking about, somebody is preaching. They were just sharing out a scripture. There's this Jesus. He sends his daughter to walk days. She walks days. Finds somebody who's a Christian, finds this magic book. They walk back to the hut. They're in this hut, and this guy, they pray. He gets up healed the next day. Then what he does is goes to all these little villages in the hills, and all he wants to do is give people a chance to know about Jesus. He said, I was sitting with this guy, and they were sitting. It was night. It's the mountains, and they're looking. There's all these little villages that no one's ever been to. And he says, you see that village? I'm going to go one day there, and I'm going to just tell them. Just give them a chance. And my friend told me as I was sitting there, he's just talking and all these, and then they went to take communion. And and he broke bread, and he said, when he gave me this bread, it was almost like he was like Jesus saying, will you partner with me in giving people a chance to walk into eternity with me? Will you partner with me in my mission of letting people know that I will provide fulfillment for them? I will do that. And as we take communion today, I want us to do it with that same heart as well. We are grateful for what he's done for us. But now it's time we're going to partner with him. That not only was it done for us, but through us, it can be done for someone else. Amen? Let's take the bread now and remember. Jesus, we remember your body broken. We can't save ourselves. Thank you for doing for us what we could never do for ourselves. Would you take and eat? This is in the same way he took a cup. You can peel back the cup now. We read it, it's on the screen. Here's what you gotta know. Covenants, we don't do this today. We make contracts. You do this, I'll do this. If you break it, nope, we're done. Covenants can't ever be broken. They always gotta be sealed by blood. So what this means is once you're with the Lord, once basically you make that covenant, his blood covers you no matter what you do. I mean, you would literally have to absolutely just run away on your own in that space. It's like there's nothing that can ever separate you from the love of God because of him pouring out. So as you drink today, especially if you're here and you're one of those that you just remember your past too much, I want you to drink and remember you are remembering something that he doesn't anymore. Let's drink now, shall we? Pray with me. Jesus, I thank you for who you are, God. And my prayer today, Lord, as we close, it's not for us. It's for our friends. It's for our family members. It's for our neighbors. It's for people whose hearts are yearning and longing and searching. God, would you put a confidence in this entire church and me to be able to be your hands and feet this week, to make invitations. God, help us to not be afraid. Help us to be courageous. And Lord, more than anything, Lord, we are expectant for you to show up next week, God, and that many would come into your kingdom. God, would you cause people's hearts to come alive in a way that only you can? God, would you cause freedoms and addictions to just fall off in Jesus' name? God, would you cause revelation in ways that only you can, God? And so we recognize you are actively doing this now. We say yes to partner with you in your mission. And so, God, we are expectant, and we will do what we can. Holy Spirit, we say yes to you here today. Would you go with us as we go out and live for you, Lord Jesus? We love you. We praise you. And all God's people said, amen. 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 All right. Well, that is it for today. Thank you guys for joining us. Don't forget these seats. By the way, if you are going to invite, can I just tell you a secret? Best time to do it is actually right now. Number one way people respond today is actually text. You know that too, because how many of you guys never answer your phone anymore? Yeah. So just throw a text, but I just want to encourage you, go ahead and pull the trigger if you can on that. Next week is Easter. If you aren't coming with anybody, what time are you coming to church?
5 and 7.
5 and 7, that's right. And if that's you in that, jump in and help if you can. But other than that, it's going to be a party next week, and we'll see you guys next Sunday or Saturday. Oh, no.
Thank you, Lord, for the hard times, for lighting the way in the dark times, for pulling me in, for giving again the times that I took it too far. I gotta thank you for keeping me humble, for picking me up when I stumble. And
hey, thank you for watching today. I want to invite you to subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video or live stream. I encourage you to share this video with a friend, and don't forget you can join us live every Sunday online or at one of our New Hope Windward locations. Thank you so much for watching today. May God bless you.
Thank you.